Good morning, Buckhead Church. How's everyone feeling? Everybody doing all right? The 11 a.m. Hey, anybody grateful for the extra hour of sleep last night? Okay. Yeah, you're like, we're good. It's 11. It feels like noon. I talked to some people this morning who were like, I didn't even know that I got an extra hour of sleep. You did, but you're here, and it's going to be a really, really great morning. Welcome to Buckhead Church. If it's your first time joining us today in person or online, I just want you to know that you're surrounded by a community of some really, really incredible people, and so we're so glad that you're here. And hey, if we've never gotten the opportunity to meet before, my name is Matt, and I'm our college pastor here at Buckhead. And if I could, come on, shout out, I'm not sure who that, yeah. but if I could just take a second to tell you about some of the things that we're witnessing and getting to experience in our college ministry here at Buckhead, that'd be really, really awesome. So if you didn't know, our college ministry is called The Living Room, and The Living Room meets on Monday nights at 8 p.m. right here in this space in our main auditorium. And each Monday night, there's about 600 college students who gather in this space. And let me just celebrate with you a few things that we've experienced this fall. So starting in August up until now, we have a table out in our lobby every single week that we call the Welcome Home Table. And basically, it's a table where we say, hey, if it's your first time with us, stop by. We want to meet you. We want to get to know your name, all of that good stuff. We've had 551 first-time students come to The Living Room this fall semester alone. which is really, really amazing. So if you just do the math, we've met 7 times this semester. So that's on average about 80 first timers a week, roughly, which is pretty incredible. Another really incredible thing is we've gotten to see and experience 48 students for the very first time put their faith and trust in Jesus, which again is pretty amazing. And then tomorrow night, actually, we have a night of worship and baptisms where we'll get to come and celebrate with 14 students who are going to go public with their faith through baptism. And so again, just a lot happening in our college ministry, a lot happening across college campuses all across our city. And it's really amazing. And I say all that to say, I just want to say from myself, from my team that I get to work with here at Buckhead Church, on behalf of a few hundred college students who you may or may not ever get the opportunity to meet, thank you. Like, thank you for your generosity as a church, truly. We couldn't do the living room and have an environment like this specifically designed for college students without your generosity. I wouldn't have a job without your generosity. So thank you for continuing to give so faithfully, where we can create amazing, irresistible environments for hundreds and hundreds of college students all across our city to gather each week and encounter Jesus in a really, really significant way. But hey, another thing I'm really looking forward to is this coming Thursday night, November 10th, we have a marriage event at Buckhead Church. And it's been a while since we've had a marriage event, and I think it's going to be a really, really powerful, special time together. There's a theme for this night. It's called Marriage is No Joke, But Sometimes You Just Have to Laugh About It. And my wife and I are really looking forward to it. It's going to be a great night, and we'll be here. And I hope that many of you can come as well. Many of you already are registered. You need to know there's still time to register, but space is very, very limited, and we're close to filling it up. So if you're thinking about coming, thinking about inviting someone, there's still time to do that, but make sure to not delay too much further. If you're watching online, you can find out more information about that on the hub, or you can scan the QR code. If you're in the room, there's a QR code right to your right, a little tiny QR code. You can scan that and it'll take you to the hub, and you can find out the information on there as well. But hey, it's gonna be a really amazing morning together here at Buckhead Church. We've got this amazing crew here leading us this morning. We got my guy Glow, Sharita, Kara, and Allison. So if you're willing and able, why don't you go ahead, stand to your feet, say hello to a couple people around you, and then we'll move forward in our service this morning.
Church, good morning. Thank you so much for being with us today. Listen, as you're saying hello to your neighbors, we just want to invite you to send up praise to our great King this morning. He inhabits the praises of his people. And so as we lift this praise, we know that the presence of God is here. Let's sing together. Come on. Let praise be a weapon that silences the enemy. Yeah, we sing your name in the dark and the chains.
everything that he's doing in my life and to see what he's doing in the life of this ministry. God is faithful and he is so deserving of our praise. And I want to sing this with you guys this morning.
Let's pray together. God, it's not lost on me that while for many of us today, because of the opportunity to open our eyes to a new day and to take in a breath this morning, the breath in our lungs being from you, and the opportunity to come into a place and freely use that breath to sing about your faithfulness and your goodness to us, it is not a really difficult thing. But for some of us who are here today, for somebody who maybe is watching online today, they're in a dark place, and it's difficult to be grateful. It's difficult to be grateful specifically to a God who we're wondering where you are in the midst of our darkness, in the midst of our difficulty, to people who are wondering if you see them and if you care. And so today, my prayer is for those people that are in that dark place. May they know that you not only see them, but that you will see them through what they're in the midst of. Help them to know they're not in a cave, they're in a tunnel, and there is a way out on the other side. And you promise to be near, to be with us, to walk with us, and to see us through the things that we're in the midst of. So I just pray some way, maybe gently, but personally and powerfully, you would whisper to them today that they would know that they matter and that you care for them, that you see them, and that you will see them through, because that's the type of God that you are. So we praise you today. We bless you today. We're grateful for you today. And I pray that we would experience you in a very personal and powerful way in the next bit of our time together. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You can go ahead and have a seat. Thank you guys so much for leading us. That was powerful. If you haven't been with us over the last few weeks, we began this Be Rich season. If you're new to our church or it's your first time in a long time, we're in the middle of our Be Rich season, which is our annual generosity campaign, giving and serving generosity campaign. And we don't have a lot of goals in this. There's not like a certain dollar amount or a certain number of hours we're wanting to serve. But we have been really upfront about our one specific goal, and it is that we want 100% participation, giving and serving. We've made it super easy for you to do it. If you scan the QR code on your chair or go to the hub if you're watching us online, there's two buttons. There's a Be Rich button for giving. There's a Be Rich button for serving. And we want you to feel a part of these projects, but it's our responsibility. It's what we're to be and what we're to do. And this is how we show up for our community. There's a bunch of great organizations that you can explore on the Be Rich website that are doing fantastic work in our community around the world. We introduced you to a couple of them the last couple of weeks. And as you saw, we're already starting to give away the resources that you give. Every dollar that comes in, no administrative fees. Every dollar that comes in is going out. We're helping tremendous organizations do good in our community, because this is the scripture that Be Rich began with. We were commanded to do good and to be rich towards others in good deeds, and to be generous and be willing to share. And so we're practicing that in this season. We hope to do it all year long, but we're really intensely practicing that in this season. I'll just say this. Some of you looked at the service projects. We've been a little slow getting people involved in service projects, probably because you look at your schedule and you're like, gosh, I don't know if I can do that. And so I want to remove every excuse possible. On our website, if you clicked on the hub, if you clicked on the serve button today, it would take you to a site that looks like this. This is on the mobile site, which, by the way, is a little harder to find these projects. But we have some specific projects that are flexible service projects that you can do anytime, anywhere, with any number of people. And here's how you find them. If you click on that serve button, it's going to take you to a site that looks like this. And in that top box, if you just scroll down a little bit, there we go. You scroll down a little bit. It says flexible service projects. You click on that. It'll take you to a site that gives you some instructions. And then you can scroll down further from that, and you can see all the projects that are available. And you can locate it. You can narrow it down by different organization. But there's tons of opportunities on there of things you can literally do anytime, anywhere. So there you go. I removed all of your excuses. You don't have to be at a certain place at a certain time. Many of you have already signed up for projects, and we hope you'll show up for those ones you signed up for. So that's awesome. We need people to engage in those. Our nonprofit partners tell us all the time When people show up for us, it's not just the financial resources we need. When people show up, the people that we serve feel loved, they feel cared for, and they feel seen. And that is a powerful thing in the lives of people that are struggling, that are under-resourced in our community. And so I hope you'll join us in showing up for people in our community. The last few weeks, we've been in the middle of a series called Heaven, Who Goes There? And if you're curious about what we've talked about, this will give you a little bit of an idea of what we've been talking about the last few weeks.
So, like most families, we had rules for our three kids, and we had two overarching rules that I've told you about before, so I won't belabor the point, but we really just had two overarching rules, and they were honor mom and don't tell a lie. That's pretty much it, and that covered a multitude of other infractions. Don't, you know, honor mom, don't tell a lie. But even though we had rules for our kids, this will come as a shock, we did not have rules for the neighbors' kids. We wanted to have rules for the neighbor's kids, but they weren't our kids. Also, unlike most families, and I wrote this down because it's a little complicated, we did not have children so there would be someone to keep the rules. Let me go over that again, because this is sort of a new thought. We did not have children so there would be someone to keep the rules. It was children first, rules second. I didn't see anybody write that down. I thought that was kind of profound. Anyway, back to that in a moment. Today we are wrapping up our three-part series, Heaven, Who Goes There? Heaven, Who Goes There? And if this is your first time or your first time in a long time joining us, I want to review real quick, and then we're going to wrap this series up. And this is what we've said from the beginning. Most people, especially most people in the United States, believe there's a heaven, and most people who believe in heaven believe that they're going to end up there. And they assume they're going to end up there because they're convinced of two things. Number one, good people go to heaven, and I'm a good person. So these are the two assumptions, right? And it makes sense why so many people would lean into these assumptions, as we said in week one. It's fair. I mean, it seems fair that good people, if there's an afterlife, if there's an eternity of some sort or heaven of some sort, and we don't all visualize that the same way, that if you're a good person, then you would go to a good place. Also, it's consistent with the idea of a good God. A good God would want good people to go to a good place if there's an afterlife. And the other reason I think everybody wants to lean into this is, come on, you're a good person. You make the cut. You especially make the cut compared to and those other people, because you all know some people. You know, we're quick to say, nobody's perfect. We apply that to us. We don't apply that to other people because that's too much grace. It's like, they should know better. Nobody's perfect. They're idiots, but nobody's perfect. You know, what's wrong with those people? Nobody's perfect. So anyway, that's just human nature. But there are people who are so much worse than you. Certainly, you are a good person compared to other people. But as we said in both of the previous episodes of this series, if you scratch beneath the surface, or if you begin asking too many questions about the good people go to heaven theory, it begins to fall apart really, really quick to begin with. And this is sort of devastating to the whole argument. Good is a moving target, right? It's a moving target historically. We talked about that. It's a moving target culturally. We talked about that. It's a moving target personally, because things that you think are okay now, you didn't think were okay a long time ago. In some other season of your life, things that were okay, now you're thinking, I can't believe I thought that was okay. So good is a constant. It's a moving target, right? And the other thing we said for people in the West, in the United States in particular, is we had to say, and don't go to the Bible, because the Bible is not helpful when it comes to trying to figure out how good a person has to be to go to heaven. The Old Testament doesn't even mention heaven the way that we think about heaven. There's certainly not a list of rules that say, hey, if you do these things, you'll go to heaven. Nowhere to be found in the Old Testament. In the New Testament, it's worse, because the New Testament authors teach that nobody is good enough to go to heaven. So if you're looking for an answer to the question, how good is good enough to earn a spot in heaven, the Bible won't help you. But the problem is, there's nothing that will help you, because there's no standard. If in fact, this kind of points to really the biggest problem in this whole way of thinking is, if good people go to heaven, then God is not good, because God would have made it clear. A good God would have made it clear. He would have shown up. I think God would have to show up every generation or so and kind of give us an updated version of what's good, because of technology and because of the way, you know, the human race has evolved. But there's no standard. There's God never showed up one single time and said, okay, I'm going to say something that's multi-generational, multi-ethnic, that everybody can understand, so everybody's on the same page, and you got to make at least a 70, and thoughts and motives count, and I'm going to take your background into, you know, all the things that when you start drilling down on this way of thinking, it makes it fall apart. There's none of that. Another way of saying it is this. God, if good people go to heaven, God's not just moving the goalpost, he's hiding the goalpost. Excuse me. He's hiding the goalpost. I've got some water, so for those of you who are reaching for your water, I'm good. I saw you down here, like, help the pastor. Save the pastor. Yeah. I need saving for sure in other areas. Anyway, so the problem is, God is not moving the goalpost. He's really hiding the goalpost. Then, as we discussed last time, and this was a big one, you know, If good people go to heaven, then Jesus was mistaken. Now, the problem with this is Jesus can't be mistaken. Or if you're not a Jesus follower, it's like, exactly, I think Jesus was mistaken about a lot of things. That would be an interesting point of discussion. But if good people go to heaven, he's clearly mistaken, because Jesus didn't teach that good people go to heaven. In fact, Jesus implied, and this is the good news for some of us, that bad people actually can make it to heaven. And then the other thing, if you read the Gospels, Jesus raised the standard for good so high that it makes us all look bad. As we said last time, I mean, here's how high Jesus raised the standard, and here's kind of how he leveled the playing field. Have you ever mistreated another person? To which we're all like, yes, or we're lying, and then we're liars, and that might be worse than mistreating another person. I don't know, because we don't know how the whole thing works. But if you've ever mistreated another person, according to Jesus, that's a sin. And you can apologize, but you can't turn back the clock. You've done permanent damage. You've hurt another person. And according to Jesus, you can't be right with God the Father if you're hurting or mistreating people that God the Father loves. Now, again, this is worth repeating. I said this last time, but if you're not a Christian, you should kind of sit up and pay attention. This might be your favorite part of the message if you've ever had a favorite part of a sermon. Because one of the things that irritates you if you're not a Christian or not a Jesus follower or maybe you're part of another religion, what irritates you is us Christians who say, you know what? We're right about God and we're right with God. We're right. We got the corner of the market. We know what God is like. We're right about God and we're right with God. And then you watch us mistreat other people and it just irritates you. It's like, how can you say you're right about God, right with God, and look at the way you treat other people? And if that bothers you, it should bother you, because that actually bothered Jesus as well. In fact, the thing he got the most bothered by were the people who claimed to be the most right about God, who didn't treat other people right. He had no patience, just like you don't. I mean, this is where you and Jesus are alike. Maybe, hopefully, a lot of us are like Jesus in this regard. He had no patience for internalized, believe-only, do-nothing religion. No patience at all. But anyway, the point is simply this, that according to Jesus, good people don't go to heaven. No one's that good, the way that Jesus defined good. What Jesus taught, as we saw last time, is that forgiven people go to heaven. And here's the crazy thing. Jesus claimed to have authority to forgive other people on behalf of God. I mean, how ridiculous is that? And his first century followers were very uncomfortable with the idea that Jesus could claim to have the authority of God to forgive other people. It really bothered them until he rose from the dead. And as we say around here, if someone can predict their own death and resurrection and pull it off, you just go with whatever that person says. If you have the authority to forgive sin, we watch you crucified. We had breakfast with you on the beach. If you say you're sent from God, if you say you and God are one, if you say you have God's authority to forgive sin, we are in. Clearly, he was sent by God with that authority. So today, as we wrap this up, we're going to kind of turn a page a little bit. And today, within the context of Jewish tradition, within the context of Christian tradition, I want to answer this question, because this question goes to the heart of why there's so much confusion. If rule keeping won't get you into heaven, then why all the rules? I mean, why is this? How did this get so confused? Why is this so confusing? Where did we even get the idea that somehow if you're a good person, you can go to heaven, or that if you clean up, you get to show up? And the answer to this question, okay, if you haven't been paying attention, the answer to this question, look up here, the answer to this question is just one more reason why you should consider or reconsider following Jesus. The best place to start is where the confusion often begins. We're going to begin with the Ten Commandments. The Ten Commandments. This is the list that people swear by but don't live by. It's so interesting. Oh, the Ten Commandments, name them. Yeah, they couldn't name them if their eternity depended on it. And there are people who somehow think, no, I keep the Ten Commandments, or I'm generally good according to the Bible, I'm going to get to heaven. It's like, well, name them. I can't name them. Well, then you can't live by them. I mean, you don't even take your own worldview seriously. Another thought for another day. But anyway, the Ten Commandments are found in the second book in the Hebrew scripture, which is also the second section or book in the Christian scripture called Exodus. And as you probably know, Exodus, the book of Exodus in the Hebrew, in the Christian scriptures, chronicles the story of ancient Israel leaving or exiting the slavery, the slave market and slavery in Egypt. Quick catch up, according to the Jewish scripture, which is part of the Christian scripture, God called a man named Abraham, said, I'm going to make you a great nation, and I'm going to bless, this is amazing, I'm going to bless the whole world, and then he made Abraham this promise. He said, I'm going to make your name great, which meant, Abraham, I'm going to make you famous. And you know what's interesting? Every single person listening and every single person in the room with me heard of Abraham before today. So put a check in that box. He became famous. We've all heard of Abraham. So there's that. Anyway, he said, I'm going to make your name great. So Abraham has a family, and one of his great grandsons takes the family to Egypt, and they multiply like crazy, and the Egyptians get nervous, and Pharaoh gets real nervous. He's like, you know what? They are outpopulating us, so let's enslave the whole family. Let's enslave this whole group and let them serve those of us who are Egyptians because they're outsiders, they're foreigners anyway. So the whole nation gets enslaved. For 400 or about 400 years, the Hebrew people are a slave state within the state of Egypt, within the nation of Egypt. And then, as you know how the story goes, God raises up another person, Moses. Moses goes to Pharaoh and says famously, look at you, all Bible scholars, let my people go. And eventually Pharaoh did, but there were some really exciting things that happened in that part. We'll skip through all that. So they exited. Now, imagine this. Here's, we don't know, a million, some people say a million, some people say up to 2 million people are leaving Egypt to go, they don't even know exactly where. And they have never lived or functioned independently. They are a slave state. They've always been told what to do. And they had a slave culture, a slave mindset. And now they're leaving, they're gonna be independent. They have no law, they have no rules, they have no civil law, they have no constitution. So God, once again through Moses, provides for them a constitution of sorts, or civil laws, including the penalties for breaking certain laws. And I don't have time to go into this much, but I got to pause and say this. Because the law of Moses gets so much criticism in our modern world. But I'm telling you, the law of Moses, when originally given in that ancient context, was way, 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 way ahead of its time. There was nothing even close, nothing near as civilized as the law of Moses. Listen, you read it. If you know anything about ancient history, the rights and protections afforded to the weak, the foreigner, servants and slaves, children and women, was so far ahead of its time. There's virtually no explanation as to how in the world this law was even written or came about. Of course, in the scripture, it says God gave it to Moses. And you almost have to believe that because it was so far ahead of its time. Slavery, just, you know, because people pick on slavery in the Bible. Slavery, according to the law of Moses, was more like indentured servitude. In other words, in the law of Moses, you could sell yourself into slavery and you could buy yourself out. And there were all kinds of rules about how you treated a servant or a slave. The whole idea of unrestricted domination of one human being over another, unrestricted, you know, no rules, domination of one human being over another is absent. In fact, it's not permitted. It's against the law of Moses to treat a slave the way that slaves were being treated and would continue to be treated all over the world. There was dignity given to every single man, woman, and child, even the foreigners, even those that sold themselves into servitude or slavery. Israel's law, as many of you know, actually formed the basis of some of our modern law. But here's the question. The law, this fabulous, way ahead of its time law, I'll give you another example in a minute, was given in chapter 20 of Exodus, not chapter 1. So the question is, what's going on for the first 19 chapters? And here's what's going on, and this is what comes back to the point of today's discussion. In the first 19 chapters, you read it for yourself, God is demonstrating his love or his concern for a group of people he considered to be his people, people he delivered. Get this, people he delivered from slavery. People he delivers from slavery before they did anything for God, before they ever kept the first part of the law, because they didn't even have the law to keep. He hadn't even given it to them yet. He delivered them from slavery pre-rules, pre-law. And why did God choose to do this? Because he wanted to. And here's the takeaway for today. With God, we're going to apply this to us in just a minute. With God, relationship always precedes the rules. This is why I said up front, we didn't have a bunch of rules in our home and go, you know what? We need some children to keep these rules. Let's have some kids because what are we going to do? There's no one to keep these amazing rules we've come up with. Let's have children, right? That doesn't work that way. Doesn't work that way with God, your Father, either. With God, God is revealed in the Old Testament. God is revealed in the New Testament. Relationship always precedes the rules. God did not give Israel the law as a means of establishing a relationship with him. God gave Israel the law because they were already in a relationship with him. The law or the rules were not a condition of relationship. They were confirmation of the relationship. Again, I did not establish a bedtime for my neighbor's children, just mine. I never disciplined my neighbor's kids. At times I wondered if their parents did either. But anyway, I'm sure at times they wondered if we disciplined our kids. Okay, that's another story for another day. So here's the point. 3 months, about 3 or 3.5 months after the nation of Israel leaves Egypt, they gather at the base of what is referred to in the scripture as Mount Sinai. And God in this moment, it's such a powerful moment. And we know bits and pieces, but it's an extraordinary story. God provides the nation a detailed, I mean a super hyper detailed constitution or law code of sorts for his people. Now, what I want to do is I want to read you a couple of portions of this because this is what sets us up for the context to understand our relationship to the rules as it has to do with being a Christian or being a Jesus follower. So listen to how it begins. It doesn't begin with thou shalt and thou shalt not. Here's essentially what I'm calling the preamble to their ancient constitution. Here's how it begins. I am the Lord, your God. We're in relationship. We have a relationship. I am the Lord, your God. And just to make sure you know who we're talking about, the very one who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. In other words, a few months ago, you belonged to Pharaoh. Now you belong to me. Once upon, not too long ago, 3.5 months ago, you belonged to Pharaoh. No freedom, no land, no hope, no future, but now you belong to me. And you belong to me without me requiring anything from you except a single act of trust. I ask that you put the blood of a lamb on your doorpost back in Egypt as an indicator that you were placing your trust in me. And now that you have placed your trust in me, and now that I have delivered you from slavery, I want you to follow me, and I want you to obey me. And then his first command. I mean, this was the easy one. You shall have no other gods before me. And they're thinking, you are exactly right. We will not have any other gods before you because we saw what you did to Egypt's gods. Now, it's so interesting. Back in those days, in ancient times, this is the way they viewed the world. Whatever nation or whatever city you lived in or whatever part of a city you lived in, there was a god for that piece of dirt. Every piece of dirt had a god. The fact, the idea that Yahweh, Israel's God, could leave wherever he was before and travel to Egypt and do battle with the Egyptian gods and to beat them in their home stadium on their own turf was unthinkable. And one by one, in a fabulous, epic way, Yahweh, Elohim, the God of the Jews, the God of the Israelites, picks off one by one by one all of Pharaoh's, all of the Egyptian gods on the home turf. It's unimaginable. It means almost nothing to us. It was beyond epic in ancient times. And so God says, hey, you know the God that did all that? That's me. I have an idea. Let's make me number one. They're like, you got it. Absolutely. We've seen what you are capable of. His message to Pharaoh, essentially God's message to Pharaoh is, hey, he went to Egypt. If we can personify God for a minute, he went to Egypt and said, hey, you got something that belongs to me. I'm not leaving here without it. And then one by one, Israel's invisible God king humiliated Egypt's pantheon of gods. And then here's the next command. Again, I can't spend a lot of time on this, but this is, again, if we could see this in the context that it originally happened, it's going to make you sit up and pay attention. This is amazing. He said, okay, here's my next law. You shall not make for yourself an image in the form of anything in heaven above or on the earth beneath or in the waters below. Now, this was so hard for them. This was the first law they disobeyed. Because this, and again, the whole idea of idol worship to us is so foreign. But listen, in every home in some ancient places, there were statues of ancestors. Everybody worshiped something they could touch. Everybody. There was always an image that represented the god. And way, 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 way ahead of its time, the God of Israel says, not you guys. No images. There is nothing that can represent me that actually represents me. In fact, get this. It would be almost 2,000 years after these laws were given, about 2,000 years before any other ancient civilization even came to the place where they could recognize that God needs no image. In fact, one of my favorite little pieces of history, I'll do this real quick, is in 63 BC. Pompey comes to Jerusalem, or comes to Judea, and basically after a long siege, he takes the city of Jerusalem, and he makes Judea a vassal state of the Roman Empire. This is the point where Rome comes in and takes over. It's about 63 BC with Pompey. So Pompey, according to historians, is so curious about this Jewish God, because here's how the rest of the world thought about the Jewish God. You're so elitist. You claim like you're the only God. Everybody knows there's not just one God. And second of all, it's like you have all these rules and your people are so strange and you make them eat stuff and they can't eat stuff. And it's the whole thing is so weird. So he has taken over Judea. He marches into the temple, bypasses all the priests and decides, you know what? He's General Pompey. I mean, he's the guy. He's like, I want to see this God I've heard so much about. I want to see this guy that's such a troublemaker, who's so exclusive, who claims to be the one and only God. And he walks into the Holy of Holies. Now, if you're not familiar with temples, every ancient temple had basically a god vault where they kept the god. And on festival days, they'd roll the idol out, and we'd all worship, and we'd roll him or her, it back in, and close the curtain. Well, the Jewish temple had a god vault. We refer to it as the Holy of Holies. So Pompey marches into the god vault like, okay, I want to see this creature. And there's this funky candle opera thing, and there's a table, and there's some treasure, and there's no image. And he's thinking, what kind of religion, they didn't call it religion back then, what kind of worship system has something you worship that you can't see? Who's ever heard of a God that doesn't have an image? Little did he know, eventually the whole world would hear of a God who didn't have an image. And just a few years later, may well say about 60 years later, God in a body would walk up those southern stairs into that temple and show up as God, Savior, Redeemer of the world. Anyway, just a little fun fact about idols. So anyway, back to the story. So there's this unprecedented. So anyway, later on the list, getting back to the Ten Commandments, later on the list, there's another really famous rule that again sets the Jewish law apart from any other law in ancient times. Everybody got a day off. Okay, never mind. Yeah, everybody got a day off. See, we think, oh, everybody has a weekend. Okay, come on. Once upon a time, there's no such thing as a weekend. Once upon a time, there's no such day as a day. There's not a day off. Everybody just works all the time. You had to work all the time to be able to eat, to be able to survive. And not only does God tell his people take a day off the Sabbath, get this, he says to them, and your slaves and your servants, they don't work either. Oh, wait. What? Yeah, your slaves and your servants. Listen, in ancient times and even in some parts of the world today, slaves, they don't get a day off. Every day is the same. I'm telling you, this was so far ahead of its time. Then, moving along, the final six of the Ten Commandments, which is kind of like a table of contents for the whole law, is about how to treat other people, how to honor other people. So basically, to summarize, it goes like this. Honor me because I rescued you. Okay, honor others because they're made in my image, and treat slaves justly because you were once a slave yourself. Don't forget where you came from. Don't forget my grace and mercy toward you. But again, these are just 10 out of about 610 commandments. And why so many? Because this was their civil law. It covered every single detail of their lives. It touched on every detail. And why did God give them such a detailed law? Because he cared. Again, the point is simply this. With God, relationship always precedes the rules. The Israelites did not behave their way in. And if you read the rest of their story, they weren't able to misbehave their way out. When you read the Bible and you get to the major and minor prophets, and it sounds like you're reading the same thing over and over and over, and who are these guys? They all just seem really angry and mad. Do you know what they were doing? They were warning God's people of how God was going to discipline them, different than how he disciplined the surrounding nations, because they belonged to him. And eventually, God literally put the whole nation in time out. Okay, and when they learned their lesson, he brought some of them back. But he never abandoned his people. Why? Because they were his people. They didn't behave their way in. They could not misbehave their way out. And here's the moral of the story. Some of you need to hear this today. What was true of ancient Israel, it's true of you. Get this, 1,500 years after this, about 1,500 years later, Jesus gathers for Passover meal with his 12 apostles. Passover, of course, was the celebration of the event of God delivering the nation of Israel out of Egypt. They celebrate this every year. So he's sitting with them at Passover. This is that annual, you know, celebration. And Jesus said something so blasphemous, I don't even have a parallel. I'll take a shot and give you an idea. But it was so blasphemous. Again, they should have all gotten up and left. But by this time, this was at the end of his ministry. They're used to him saying these kinds of things. So they're participating in the Passover meal. They've done this ever since they were children. Always the same routine, same food, you know, same thing, repeat the same thing, answer the questions the same way. And Jesus says, from now on, referring to Passover, I want you to do this in remembrance of me. As I've said before, and this is the best parallel I can think of, it would be like me coming in here on the first weekend in December and saying, hey, you know how in December we celebrate the birth of Jesus? Well, from now on, we're going to celebrate my birthday. Yeah, it's not even funny, is it? It's like, no, I mean, that's the end. You leave or I leave. Somebody's going to leave. Somebody's going to get hurt. You don't, wait, you can mess with a lot of things, how we baptize, how we do communion. But no, Andy, sorry. You know, you need serious help. This is a little bit of what it must have felt like that night. From now on, you're not going to celebrate God delivering our people from Egypt. We're going to celebrate something completely different. What God, this is amazing, what God did for our people centuries ago, he was saying, God is about to do for the whole world. And it will be an invitation to trust, and it will be an invitation to relationship. He goes on and he says this. He says, this cup that you've taken so often that always meant something different, this cup is a brand new arrangement, a brand new covenant, a brand new kind of relationship. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which they did not understand until the next day when he shed his blood for your sin, my sin, and for the sin of the world. As God delivered our people from physical slavery, Jesus was saying, tomorrow I'm going to deliver the world from slavery to the ultimate consequence of sin. And the term and condition for this contract is going to be the same as it was 1,500 years ago. A single expression of trust. Paul, who shows up, you know, as a Pharisee, really good Pharisee, he reminds us how good a Pharisee he was. Then when he becomes a Jesus follower, as I said last week, he reminds us that he's the chief of all sinners. It's like, what's wrong with you? I met Jesus. I see the world a different way. So he eventually understood. He understood because he was schooled in religious thought and Jewish thinking. He understood the parallel between God's delivering and demonstrating his power to deliver Israel and the parallel between that and God demonstrating his power to deliver us from sin. He writes that just as God demonstrated his love for Israel, God demonstrates his own love for us in this, ready? While we were still slaves in Egypt, while we didn't have a clue as to what was going on, before we even knew we had a problem that needed solving, while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. And again, the reason this is an important word to the Apostle Paul is because he was alive when Jesus died, and it dawns on him, wait a minute, I'm out here doing it all wrong. I'm out here clueless. And then not only am I clueless, I'd persecute the church and have Christians arrested. And Jesus died for my sin while I am alive and getting it 100% wrong. He died for me. This is literal for Paul. He died for me while I was still alive, a sinner and an enemy. But the way it applies to you and to me is this: before we did anything, before we knew there was anything to do, to be done, God, your heavenly Father, did something for you. Two verses later, he says this: for if while we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to him, that is, we were restored to him through, how were we reconciled to God? Through what? Through, by what means? By rule keeping? He's like, no, through the death of his son. The reason, the arrival of Jesus, come on. The reason the arrival of Jesus is such good news for you and such good news for me is that we don't good our way in. That's what makes it good news. We don't behave our way in any more than my children behave their way into my family. The best news of all, we can't bad our way out any more than my children can misbehave their way out of my family. I am their father either way, and your heavenly Father stands as your heavenly Father either way. And if you are or have ever been overwhelmed with your guilt and shame and think, how in the world could God love me? You just remember this. You didn't get in by being good. You cannot get out by being bad. He loves you unconditionally. This was the scandal of the gospel. This is the thing that set it apart from every other worldview. It's why Jesus had to punctuate these audacious claims by rising from the dead and defeating the ultimate penalty of sin, which is death. This is why Jesus didn't say, you ready for this? This is why Jesus didn't say, you must behave again. He said, no, Nicodemus, you must be born again, because this is family. This is relationship. So why all the rules for Israel? Well, God was not attempting to make bad people good. He was attempting to make his keep his free people free. And the same is true for you, and the same is true for me. With God, as with all good parents, relationship always precedes the rules. Which means we are reconciled, or we are made right with God. We are reconciled to God by grace, which means, you know why he did it? He did it because he wanted to. Just like he chose Abraham, just like he chose Israel, he just wanted to. He didn't see anything in you or anything in me that made us special. He just wanted to. We're reconciled to God by grace. And if you're stuck with some sort of paradigm that says, okay, yeah, that's the Jesus thing, that's the Christian thing, I don't buy any of that, I just know there's an afterlife and I'm going to figure it out and I'm good enough, I just want you to know you're going to spend the rest of your life trying to figure out how good is good enough. And no one's going to tell you, because no one knows, because that's not the way it works. We're reconciled to God through grace. And then, after we're in, we choose to follow out of gratitude. And Jesus said, let me tell you how I want that to look. Here's the rule. I just want you to do for others what God, your heavenly Father, did for you. Now, here's how I want to close, kind of turning another page. I want to offer an apology to, if you're not a Christian, I'm not a Jesus follower, or you haven't been for a long time, maybe you're of another faith tradition. I just want to say this. If one of us Christians has ever attempted to impose one of our rules on you and shamed you because you don't keep our rules. I mean, they're saying, but the Bible says, God says, Jesus said, any of that stuff. That you, if you've ever been shamed or you felt like one of us was trying to impose our rules on you, I just want to say, I am so sorry. How you choose to live your life, and you know this, but you just need to know at least one of us understands this, and there's more than just one. How you choose to live your life is none of our business. In fact, this is going to shock you. This may be your favorite verse in the Bible. And in fact, what I'm about to read, I just want to say a lot of Christians don't know this verse. But here it is, been there for 2,000 years. In fact, it comes from some of the oldest Christian literature. Here's what Paul said to first century Christians as it relates to our relationship with people like you, perhaps that don't believe or used to believe or just don't buy it. Here's what he said. He said, Make it your ambition. In other words, this is a big deal, front and center, all the time, every day. Make it your ambition to lead a quiet life. Here it is. You should mind your own business. See, you should read the Bible. There's stuff like this in there, right? It's like, I like Paul. I like that guy, right? It's like exactly Christians. Look, live your life. Do what you want to do. Don't do what you don't think you ought to do. It's fine. But leave me alone. It's my life. And Paul would say, exactly. We have no business trying to tell you how to live your life. Just mind your own business. And he goes on to say, just work with your hands. Do your job. Be good parents. Be responsible. So that your daily life may win the respect of outsiders. So, if you have lost respect for Christians and for the church or people who do what I do because you felt like they're constantly trying to impose their Christianity, their Christian standards, their rules, and their laws on you, I'm sorry. That's not how it's supposed to work. And if we had been paying attention to our own scripture, we would not have made you feel perhaps the way that we made you feel. But while our rules don't apply to you, the good news is God's love certainly does. If Jesus was correct, and of course Jesus was correct. If Jesus was correct according to Jesus, God loves you as if you already belong to him. So his invitation to relationship is a standing relationship. And it's an invitation that's accepted not through promises to do better. It's an invitation that's accepted by simply acknowledging what he's already done for you. Because as John, who knew Jesus personally, would write later, for God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Who goes to heaven? Forgiven people go to heaven. How do we gain through forgiveness? Through Christ, our Lord, the Son of God, who came to be the Savior of the world. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, it's not complicated, but sometimes it's unbelievable. So give us eyes to see, ears to hear, courage to respond. Father, I pray that we being those of us who claim to be your followers, would get this right, that we would live our lives in such a way that people would lean in and wonder, why are they so different? Why are they so kind? Why do they exhibit such self-control? Why are they so patient? Why are they, well, they're just good people. And it's not because we're earning anything. We're just responding to something good. And Father, for the person that maybe is listening today and they got it for the first time, it's like, oh, I see. I just never saw it that way before. Give them the wisdom to know what to do with what they just heard and the courage to do it. We pray all of this in the matchless name of our Savior who died for our sins so we didn't because we couldn't. It's in his name that we pray. Amen.
Well, as always, we hope this conversation goes beyond just the time that we're together here and goes outside of these walls. And so there's some questions for reflection and discussion. If you go to the hub using the QR code or just buckheadchurch.org/the hub, you can get those discussion questions there. But I want to press just a little bit further. If you're here today or if you're watching us online and this is the first time you've ever heard this good news or in this way and it sort of clicked today, I just want to encourage you, don't leave here without telling somebody. Don't leave here without talking to somebody. Find somebody on our staff. Find one of our volunteers if you didn't come with somebody. Or maybe the person you came with, they would love to have a discussion. Maybe you have questions more about what it looks like to enter into a personal relationship with God through Jesus. We would love to help you take the right next steps in that conversation. So don't leave today without talking to somebody. We have an environment called Starting Point. You can find out more information about on our website. Where we help people through that very thing, a discussion and starting a new relationship with God through Jesus, a personal and intimate relationship. And it's why we're here. And we want to help you engage in that type of relationship with a God who loves you and sees you and accepts you just the way that you are. So please take the next right step for you. We're praying that God will help you to know what that is. Next week, as we're finishing one thing, we're starting something new. Next week, we're beginning a brand new series, and it's called Intimate Encounters. How's that for a hook? We're going to open the scriptures, and we're going to talk about what true intimacy is. And in a very hypersexualized culture, I believe that our capacity and the literature, it proves that our capacity for experiencing true intimacy has been eroded. And so we're going to talk about that. We're going to talk about the components to experiencing intimate relationships. And so whether you're single, whether you're married, whether you're engaged, you're dating, whatever your circumstances, it's going to be relevant for you. We're going to talk about what true intimacy looks like and the components for experiencing that. I hope you'll join us next week. And it's a great opportunity to invite somebody. I promise not to embarrass you. It will be challenging, but I think it'll be incredibly insightful as well. So that begins next week. Don't forget, we're kicking that sort of off with this event coming up this Thursday. You don't have to be married to come to the event, by the way. If you're in a long-term relationship or if you're engaged, we'd love to have you at the event on Thursday night. As Matt said earlier, space is limited, but it's going to be a lot of fun. Some of you know Ted Cunningham. He's actually going to be our speaker at it. He's hilarious and he's incredibly wise. He's had a tremendous impact on our relationship, mine and Jen's. So I hope you'll join us for that next week. Make sure you come, bring somebody. But until then, I hope you'll go and we'll be good. We'll do good. We'll be generous towards people and we'll be the church where we live, work, and play. We'll see you next Sunday right back here at Buckhead Church. Have a great week.